microbes that you know, this experimentation and designing them both to survive the journey and to survive a variety of conditions once we get there. We don't know if there'll be the temperature, we don't know the chemical conditions, the pH. There are many factors, whether or not there will be air or anaerobic conditions.
Mm.
So what we did find is now in the last 10 or 20 years, there's a lot of research motivated by astrobiology, actually, on extremophile microbes that can survive under very, very extreme conditions of salinity and pH and the temperature and radiation.
Mm.
So what I would suggest is that we can put a combination of these types of microbes in these capsules, and also we develop by genetic engineering these microbes that can even endure many different conditions or even more harsh conditions than that.
Huh.
Probably the biggest question to address, but to a large degree we can address it here by in the laboratory.
But do you think that life will adapt to these circumstances to where they end up, so to speak, or where it ends up? Because as we know, life is very, you know, as long as we have a big gene pool of what we send out there, the ability to adapt seems to be one of the prominent properties of DNA and microorganisms as such anyway. So do you think that they might just adapt to the new circumstances wherever they end up and actually make life happen there as well? What's your theory about that, Michael?
Well, that's what we are hoping for, of course. Certainly there have to be the right conditions. There have to be some form of water, if we are talking about biological life as we know it. Could be even maybe icy, but some form of water is necessary. So there are limits to the temperatures. It cannot be much more than 100 degrees centigrade and cannot be much below zero centigrade. Other than that, there are a large scale of conditions where life already exists now.
Mm.
But of course, once it gets started, then it will have the capacity to adapt for a fairly broad range of conditions. Now, of course, what we hope is that the life that is sent there eventually will develop into advanced beings and maybe intelligent beings like us, who then, in their turn, a long time from now, will send the missions or the travelers even further into the galaxy so life can expand, keep going.
Hmm.
In order to facilitate that, it would be very good if we can find out that it's possible from a survival point of view, to include organisms, for example, such as the organism that I like to consider for this called rotifers, which are microscopic little animals, but which are already differentiated in a basic body plan that is similar to our body plan. It's an outside and inside, the stomach, digestive organs, can move. Now, the point is that on Earth, it took billions of years from the beginning, from the first cyanobacteria, until the multicellular eukaryotic organism developed. That was a big, big block to advanced evolution. And if we can bypass that, we have a long way, we've gone a long way to assure that life can advance in this new habitat to these more advanced forms.
Hmm.
Life will just have to take its own course of how it will develop.
Yes, of course. One of the things you suggest as well is when you talk about higher forms of you know, evolution or certain types of microorganisms, you mentioned, I think it's called rotifier eggs. Is that how you pronounce it?
Rotifier, R-O-T-I-F-E-R.
Yes.
Rotifier.
What is that? Tell us about that.
Well, again, these are small microscopic organisms that live on Earth. You can find them in fresh water, you can find them in salt water. Very common, little animals. But we are, and they are still under harsh conditions, dryness, and so they develop this very, very hardy cysts that can hibernate, so to speak, for a long, long time, and then when the conditions are right, they come alive again. Hmm. And they're probably the best candidates, and they can live, actually, they eat algae, so if you have an environment where algae can develop, cyanobacteria, then these rotifers can eat them and survive also. So this is probably one of the best candidates to send to start higher evolution in this environment. Now again, the point is that if you send them to these planets which are just forming now, they're certainly not going to be ready to support these little animals. But just like you said at the beginning, the idea that microorganisms were trapped in meteorites and asteroids and then ended up on Earth. Mm. Our missions can, these capsules with these microbes, can be captured into asteroids and comets in these new worlds. And then they will be delivered there maybe even a very long time from now. Meanwhile, they will be protected because it's very cold. The comets are very cold.
Yes.
And shielded. And then some of them will eventually, by collisions, or enter in the inner solar system of that solar system, and might be delivered to that new planet maybe a billion years from now, when there's already an oxygen atmosphere created by the cyanobacteria in the first place.
Hmm.
And that's a scenario that certainly would be. We have nothing to lose, but a lot to gain by including these organisms also in these missions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I see what you mean. How would you go about, putting it into an asteroid, for example? Have you thought about how to propel this forward? Do we shoot this out there, so to speak, and do we inject this into the asteroid, or do we create the asteroid, or how? How would we go about doing that if we indeed would like to have the delivery method, so to speak, in form of an asteroid?
Well, what we would do is we send very large amounts, very large numbers of these capsules. Now, what are capsules? I'm talking about, for example, each one is only a 0.1 microgram, so you can send 10 million capsules in a gram of material, or 10 billion in a kilogram of material. And then they, either as a cloud of these tiny little solar cells, each one sailing in that direction, or put it in some object that will disintegrate and then disperse these capsules when it gets to the right places. When it arrives to these places, the asteroids and the comets are just being formed there. So these capsules will become part of the dust that gets incorporated naturally into the asteroids and comets. And then it will be just again shielded and saved there in the cold, extreme cold conditions until the time is right, until some of it will end up in the planet.
Hmm.
So when we plan these missions, we can estimate what is the probability of these capsules being captured, arriving at their target, how precisely we can aim, how large is the target, how much material is there, and how much will this capsule, this mass of capsules be diluted by the natural dust there.
Mm.
So that after all of that, how much dust is delivered to the planet? And if you consider all of that, then we can estimate of how much material that you'll need to send for a reasonable chance of success.
Mm.
And it comes down. Yeah, go ahead.
Oh no, I just want to say, and you've calculated various things here. I think you suggest somewhere here about 100 tons of microbial.